Awesome. Well, I'm excited to talk about the rain factor today. And this idea is very powerful inside of my own soul. And I really want to plant this kind of prophetic picture in your heart, in your mind, in your spirit. I hope we recognize the power of the images that we set in front of us and the impact that they have on our life. And, you know, there's a lot of images that are coming at us that are negative images. You know, there's a lot of negative noise. There's a lot of negative images. There's a lot of things. And I believe it was Paul Scanlon a couple of weeks ago talking about, you know, if you got negative talk going on the inside, what are you going to do about it? How are you going to change that? And I want you to get a picture inside of you that can start to declare a future for you. I remember this story in the Old Testament when Jacob was serving his father-in-law Laban, and Laban was misusing and mistreating Jacob and having him serve and kind of cheating him out of wages and wives and all this kind of stuff that was going on. And he was a shepherd for his father-in-law Laban for several years, and they came up with an agreement that whatever one of the sheep would come out spotted or striped would become Jacob's, but all the great pure white sheep would stay Laban's. And Laban thought, I'm going to win on this deal. And Jacob did something that I think is compelling and interesting. He took almond strips, almond branches, trees, branches, and he tore strips so that there would be stripes on those strips, that, and then put those in front of where the sheep were both feeding and mating. And the result of that, of what he put in front of them, was that they began to reproduce striped and spotted sheep more and more and more. And it's just a great Bible story and a symbol for us to understand that what you set in front of you, you end up producing. What you set in front of you, you end up reproducing. And so it is important to be extremely intentional about what you put in front of you, and that you are purposely choosing biblical ideas and positive ideas and faith-filled ideas, putting those in front of you. So I want to help you a little bit with that. So our ushers are going to hand out right now a magnet, and I'm making our ushers work hard this morning. Could you give a great big hand? Because they're having to hand out this a lot of things today. So thank you guys so much. You're incredible. So this is Psalm 65. It's the kind of the passage that we're on. It's a passage that I felt like the Holy Spirit spoke to my heart in the fall for our church for 2017. And I want you to take this, and this will go perfectly on your fridge. And we have a couple of them. We actually did another version of this a while back at Heart for the House, but this is a new and improved version. And I almost every morning when I'm praying, I pull this off the fridge, and I am walking around praying these words and declaring these words. And so let me read this to you. Psalm 65, this is the passage that we're building this rain factor concept out of. Psalm 65, verse 9, you take care of the rock church. It says the earth, but this is our piece of the earth. You take care of the rock church and water it, making it rich and fertile. The river of God has plenty of water. It provides a bountiful harvest of grain, for you have ordered it so. You drench the plowed ground with rain, melting the clods and leveling the ridges. You soften the earth with showers and bless its abundant crops. You crown the year with a bountiful harvest. Even the hard pathways overflow with abundance. The grasslands of the wilderness become a lush pasture. The hillsides blossom with joy. The meadows are clothed with flocks of sheep. The valleys are carpeted with grain. They all shout and sing for joy. What a great picture. This is a picture that I want you to be able to carry around on the inside of you. The concept of rain as a symbol in the Bible is, rain is a symbol of God's blessing in the Bible. So there's a bunch of scriptures, but I just give you one. And this is maybe not a bad scripture to pray as well. Deuteronomy 28:12 says, "The Lord will open for you his good storehouse, the heavens, to give rain to your land in its season and to bless all the work of your hand. And you shall lend to many nations, but you shall not borrow." And what I want us to recognize about the rain factor is, the rain factor is when God's blessing pours out onto your world. That there is a significant difference made when the blessing of the Lord is on what you put your hand to. When the blessing of the Lord is on your life, that God is blessing the things that you are attempting to do, that God is restoring what the enemy has stolen from you, that God is restoring dreams that have become maybe dry and dusty and dormant. And so what I'm asking you to do, especially those of you that would feel like, this is my home church, this is where I belong, and I want to lean in to God's best for my church, is I'm asking you to take this passage of scripture and that I believe the Holy Spirit has spoken, giving to us for this year, and begin to declare this over your church. Use it to declare over your business, over your family, over your life. And I have found that this passage is actually giving me language to pray with. It is giving me words and pictures and concepts as I pray this, and there'll be something that'll stand out to me. What I want to encourage you to do is, don't just talk about your dry, dusty field, but prophesy rain over your field. Don't just talk about your mountain that's in front of you, but the Bible, Jesus literally taught us this idea. Speak God's word to your mountain. Come on, you know this idea, but let me just read these verses to you. Mark 11, verse 22 says, "Jesus answered, saying to them, 'Have faith in God. Truly, I say to you, whoever says to this mountain, be taken up and cast into the sea, does not doubt in his heart, but believes that what he says is going to happen, it will be granted to him.' The words that come out of your mouth are powerful. And you've got to watch those words and make sure those words are in alignment with God's word. You can't just talk negative all day long and expect God to move in your life. We've got to align our heart, our words, our mind with the will of God. Mark 11:24, "Therefore I say to you, all things for which you pray and ask, believe that you have received them, they will be granted to you." So I'm praying this in the mornings, and I'm just praying this and saying, "Lord, the river of God has plenty of water." And there'll be mornings that just thought dominates my thinking. There's no shortage with God. There's no, like, somebody gets a piece of it and then it takes away a piece from me. No, the river of God has plenty of water, right? And then it provides a bountiful harvest, and that I can lean in to what God has for us. And it says, "You have ordered it so. You drench the plowed ground with rain. You crown the year with a bountiful harvest. Even the hard pathways overflow with abundance." I'm just saying to you, this will give you language to declare God's truth over your life. This will give you language and concepts and ideas that you can begin to pray over your world and prophesy something different than you've already experienced. Somebody say amen. So last week, I talked for a few moments about a couple of ideas. Number one is that the Rock Church belongs to God, and so do you. And the idea, Psalm 65, verse 9 says, you take care of the Rock Church. And I want you to lean into the fact that God wants to take care of you. He loves you. He's for you. And you can lean into that. You take care of the Rock Church and water it, making it rich and fertile. And then secondly, we talked about this idea that the rain factor produces abundance. And as you read through this, you see all these ideas that portray the concept of abundance. It's, you know, there's a couple of phrases that I love. The river of God has plenty of water. Everybody say plenty. It provides a bountiful, everybody say bountiful, harvest of grain. You crown the year with a bountiful harvest. Even hard pathways overflow with abundance. And the thing I want to keep in front of us is this idea. Don't let a season of lack make you forget the enduring nature of God, of God's abundance and God's blessing. You may have had a dry season, but that doesn't mean that God has dried up. Amen. And you may have had not the most fruitful season, but that doesn't mean that the next season can't be exceedingly fruitful. So let me take a few minutes today and talk about some ideas that that spring out of this passage and this idea. Number three is this concept. The kingdom of God operates and grows agriculturally. I know, don't shout me down. I know that's just a, but let me help us see something. This picture is obviously an agricultural picture, right? And the Bible, though it was set in a time when things were primarily agricultural, the Bible is full of agricultural analogy. There's all kinds of things that have to do with seeds and plants and trees and seasons and all that. We live in a technological age. I am a technology lover. I may be at times quasi-obsessed with new technology. I love all that kind of stuff. I'm very drawn to it, and I love tinkering around with it. And we are used to technology making things happen fast. So every new iPhone, every new laptop, every new pad, iPad, or whatever you would use, every new TV, it's the new and improved faster version, right? The chip is faster. The thing is going to take place much faster, way faster than that old three-year-old model. Way faster than that flip phone, right? Is what, way faster than what you have now. And the thing I want to point out, or a thing I want to point out, is that real life is actually far more agricultural than technical. I wish there was an app that I could load onto my phone that would make me lose 15 pounds. Anybody know what I'm talking about? Here's what I know. Weight comes off slow. Right? You started your diet this morning And by this afternoon, you get on the scale hoping 3 pounds are gone. But in actuality, it comes off slow. To become healthy or fit when you haven't paid any attention to that comes slow. Maturity, stability, character comes slow. Real talent is developed slow. These guys up here playing instruments, I promise you, there have been hundreds, thousands of hours that they have behind the scenes, unseen, noodled around and figured out how to play that guitar, how to do that, and to develop what they have. It happens slow. Education happens slow. 12 years. That's a long time. And then that's just high school. If you decide you want more education, it comes slow. Saving accounts grow slow. I'm just saying to you that you got to buy the idea that real life is far more agricultural than technological. The Bible is full of agricultural pictures that help us understand. Jesus is the vine, we are the branches. You got to get that idea. The Bible gives us these ideas that take us tiny little mustard seed. This is what the kingdom of God is like. The smallest seed you could find, little bitty thing. Plant a small seed and watch it grow into a big tree over time. Trees don't grow fast, right? The Bible gives us all these stories about trees bearing fruit and good fruit and bad fruit and giving it time or eventually chopping it down. In other words, the Bible is telling us that the way God works is agricultural. It doesn't happen as fast as we wanted it to happen. Isaiah 30 verse 23, there's just tons of passages that would point to this, but it's the Bible says, he will give you rain. Everybody say rain. He will give you rain for the seed which you will sow in the ground and bread from the yield of the ground, and it will be rich and plenteous. That's Bible language. On that day, your livestock will graze in a roomy pasture. Amen. And what I want to point out for us this morning is to recognize that life is not just math. You want your math correct when you're doing your taxes. I taught a series of messages several years ago called Don't Do Math in History Class. Because the things that really matter in life, math is important, but what's really going to make your life flourish isn't just getting everything tidy and right and getting all the numbers calculated just perfectly. Don't do math when it's time to think agriculture. I'm not very good agriculturally. At least that's what I tell my wife, so I don't have to work in the garden. But I'm really not that good at plants and gardens and all that kind of stuff. But on several years, Suzette has planted tomato plants in our garden, and we even had a couple of just serendipitous kind of tomato plants come up. And I have to admit, it always astonishes me every year how many tomatoes come off a tomato plant. I mean, it's way more than I could ever eat. It's way more than our family could consume. So it actually produces more than enough. Anybody following my thought here? And what we want to happen fast often doesn't really work well, but what begins to happen when we understand that the kingdom of God may seem to be moving slower than we want it to move, it always produces more than enough. It always gives us enough to share. Every winter, I have a guy that comes and he's got a little crew, and they come in and trim our gardens back. And when they trim our gardens back, it feels like and looks like there's hardly anything left. Everything gets trimmed back so far in the winter, but what we've learned year after year after year is that if we trim it back in the winter season, it grows back fruitful and healthy in the spring and summer season. And the Bible tells us this idea. John 15, Jesus said, every branch in me that does not bear fruit, he takes away. But every branch that even bears fruit, he prunes it so that it may bear more fruit. And I really felt like I wanted to say this to someone today, that just maybe God has pruned off people from your life, that you are moaning or bemoaning the loss of that person, but the truth is, maybe God is setting you up for a more fruitful season, right? Maybe God has pruned off some stuff or some attachments that were holding you back. His idea that he has in mind for us is that he wants to bring us into greater fruitfulness. Come on, the kingdom of God grows. The kingdom of God operates agriculturally. You can't pull on the leaves and make the tree grow. The fourth thing I want to talk about as we look at this passage is this idea. God always works in divine partnership. God always works in divine partnership. So verse 10 of Psalm 65 puts it this way. You drench the plowed ground. Everybody say plowed ground. You drench the plowed ground with rain, melting the clods, leveling the ridges. You soften the earth with showers and bless its abundant crops. So God provides for us the seed. God provides the soil. God provides the sunshine. God provides the rain. So he does the bulk of the work, but we get to plant. We get to plow. My emphasis in this series, if you will, is more on the reign of God than on our effort. But I also want us to stop and remember that we all have a part to play in this thing. And our part is small, but we are partnering with God in creating life. As a matter of fact, we don't actually create. What we do is learn God's pattern and learn how to cooperate. So our job is not create a great life. Our job is notice the way God works and partner with it. Our partnership with God is not like we're somehow equal partners. Okay, God, I'll do my part, you do your part. It's like, okay, I'll do my part and you do your part, right? But what I've discovered is that this whole idea of cooperating with God, of partnership with God, is vital for life. It's to live a blessed life, to live a thriving life, to live in a way that looks like you're a Psalm 65 kind of person. It's mostly learning how to cooperate, how to cultivate, how to see how God works, and then kind of get out of God's way and kind of get out of your own way so that you could allow Him to do the great thing He wants to do. There's an interesting concept that I've noticed in Genesis. In Genesis 1, there is all of these concepts where God says, let there be. You know, let there be light, let there be fish, let there be animals, let there be. God is declaring all this as kind of a big, broad picture. In Genesis 1:11, it says, so God said, let the earth sprout vegetation, plants yielding seed and fruit trees bearing fruit after their kind, with seed in them on the earth. And it was so. And so the earth brought forth vegetation and plants yielding seed after their kind and trees bearing fruit with seed in them after their kind. And God saw that it was good. So God says in Genesis 1, let there be. But then we get to Genesis 2 and verse 5. And I want you to notice this. It says, even though God said, let there be, now we're going from macro to micro. Now no shrub of the field was yet in the earth. Even though God said, let there be, no shrub of the field was yet in the earth, and no plant of the field had yet sprouted. So God said, let there be, but there wasn't, because there were two ingredients missing. One is, the Lord God had not sent rain upon the earth. And two was, there was no man to cultivate the ground. No plant, no shrub yet. Even though God said, let there be. Because two missing factors. No man to cultivate. No rain falling from heaven yet. And here's what I want us to get. God placed the potential for fruitfulness into the earth. God placed the potential for a thriving life into every person. But there's no Garden of Eden until there's a person to cultivate. Not create, cultivate. And there's no rain. So what I want to say is that you could sit in church and read this or listen to me say it, Psalm 65, and you understand the river of God has plenty of water. It provides a bountiful harvest, for you have ordered it so. Woo-hoo-hoo. It sounds awesome. But this is just, let there be light. Let there be plants. There's still got to be something in you that says, I got to plow my little piece of ground. Come on, you hear me? I got to plow my little piece of ground. I got to cultivate this thing that God, this little piece of the earth that God's given me. God gave me these kids. I got to cultivate that relationship. Sow into their life. It comes slow. God gave me this marriage. I got to cultivate. It's not what you do on the big occasion. It's what you do every day. that creates a healthy marriage. God gave me this job, and we want the big, we want the breakthrough day. And I'm not saying there isn't a breakthrough day, because when those tomatoes start showing up, it feels like a breakthrough day. But God takes often a long time to move suddenly, right? And I'm just saying to you today that everything God wants to do in the earth is always a cooperative effort between God and man. God created you with the potential to live a thriving, fruitful life. But it's learning that cooperation, that cultivation. I remember one time I was cutting my grass in the previous house that I owned, and right next to my yard was a field that had not been developed yet. And when I cut my grass and I pushed my mower next to this field, it just dawned on me one day that this field was full of thorns and thistle and trashy kind of vegetation. And I'm realizing that my manicured lawn used to look like that until I showed up to cultivate it. But here's what I know. I could plant seed. I could cut grass. I could use fertilizer. I could do everything that needs to happen. But if there's no rain from heaven, it's not going to work. Can you hear what I'm saying? It's always a divine partnership to see God do great things in our life. I want to pray with you today. Would you bow your heads, please, and close your eyes? Father, I'm praying for every person in this room that has felt a dry and dusty season. Maybe in their walk with you, maybe in their marriage, maybe in their ministry, maybe in their career. I believe you want to pour rain out into our lives. And we are here to say, Lord, we receive your rain. If you're here today, every head bowed, please, every eye closed. If you're here today, maybe you've never really surrendered your life to this God who loves you so much. I would love to pray with you. You know where you really stand in your relationship with the Lord. Maybe you're here today and you know there was a day when you used to be close to God, but you're not today. This would be a great day for you to come home. Or maybe you just feel unsure about where you stand with God. If you say, Pastor, I know I need to make a move forward. I know I need to open my heart to allow God to pour his rain into my life, to allow him to bring his blessing into my world. Would you pray with me? You say, I want to give my life to Christ. I want to come back to him. I want to just be sure I'm right with God. I want you to lift your hand all over this room and say, that's me. Would you pray for me? Just lift your hand real high and say, yeah, I need God. I want God in my life. Thank you. Thank you. Let's pray together. Everybody say this. Everybody say, Lord Jesus, I open my life to your love, to your lordship. I need you. I want you in my world. I know I've sinned, so I come to the cross where you paid the price for my forgiveness. Thank you for a fresh start, a new beginning. Help me become the person you created me to be. Amen. Come on, let's thank the Lord.